Hey everybody, and welcome to Dudes Brunch, a podcast about pop culture and internet garbage and black coffee. I'm your host, Taylor Olmsted, and back from a week off, it's Tyler Reed. Tyler, welcome back to the show. What did you have for brunch today?
Hey everybody. Oh, it's so good to be back. It's been such a long time away from all of you. I've been eating like absolute trash and eating at about 11 p.m. for two nights in a row. So I decided to have a little bit of restraint. I had just a small one single pastry today. But then later I had sleepy bee because I was like, well, fuck it. I got to eat something during work.
Did you get that get a sandwich from Sleepy Bee?
I did. I had been getting just a small takeaway box of Indian buffet food the last few weeks. And I was like, not today. I gotta get my brunch on. It's finally time. It was good. It was delicious. It was everything I wanted and more.
I'm proud of you. And also, man, I love that sandwich from Sleepy Bee. Sean Evans is here. Sean, what did you have for brunch today?
Today, Sarah made pancakes. I gave her just one pro tip, and they were really good. Turns out that heat is the key.
So what is the appropriate heat for cooking pancakes?
Okay, so on my stove, it is 5 o'clock. Dial turned to 5, pancakes ready to jive. You can remember it like that, kids. But generally, the way to do it is if you take, like, I usually run my hand underwater and then walk right up to the stove and just kind of flip the water onto the pan, and it should, like, sizzle and bubble around before it evaporates. If it immediately evaporates, it's way too hot. If it just sits on there, it's way too cool. So look for the sizzle.
You heard it here first, folks. That's how you cook your pancakes.
Cook them like a Snoop Dogg. Sizzle my nizzle.
And joining us again, it's the belated birthday girl, Catherine DiMartino. Catherine, happy birthday. Welcome back. What did you have for brunch today?
Thank you. I am like super low on food, so please don't make fun of my brunch. but I think I just had cottage cheese, like a little self-serving, one single serving, which sounds really pathetic, but that's because I'm like on, you know, like trying to get to Tuesday so I can use my car again. But if I had made pancakes, I would make them on a griddle and put it on 450 if possible.
That's an ambitious amount of heat for pancakes.
Well, you can do like 3, it depends on, you know, everybody's set a little bit different, so you could do like 350 to 450, but if it comes out like kind of bubbly looking, it's too low, and you need to turn it up so it gets that like kind of caramelized looking surface. Anyway, that's my pro tip for pancakes.
Can we all agree that the pancake must be completely like solid / baked all the way through and not runny in any way?
Yeah, raw flour's bad.
I just wanted to make sure.
I feel like you can't really mess with that kind of recipe. Like, it's not a steak. You kind of got to cook the whole thing.
You say that, but I'm sure somewhere on the internet there is someone who is really into runny pancakes, and to that I say, no sir.
Yucky.
Well, I am your host, Taylor, and for brunch today, oh, you guys, you're all going to be so proud of me. I went ham on brunch today.
With ham?
Not with ham.
Oh, I saw it on social media.
The brunchiest brunch I have ever brunched. Friend of the show, Lucas Chaffin, who has been on a few times, and other friend of the show, Olivia Bullock, and I went out to brunch today. Olivia visiting Atlanta from Ohio, and we went to Babalu Tacos and Tapas here in Atlanta, which is a taco restaurant that also does kind of Americanized tapas, and they started the brunch with guac made table side with exactly the amount of spices and peppers and things that we wanted put in it, then bottomless mimosas, and then we each had our main course, which mine was crab cakes benedict, and then a whole bunch more mimosas. We ended up sitting on the patio drinking mimosas from noon until 5, and it was the longest and most intense brunch session I think I've ever been a part of.
Oh, buddy, they probably gave you orange juice about halfway through that.
Nah, they poured them in front of us.
Oh, shit.
I am mildly day drunk right now, and it is glorious.
Hell yeah.
So,
what a great way to open the episode.
side shout out. I got my dad a Father's Day card, and it's the Studio Ink Hallmark version. And might I say that it was the tastiest letter I have ever licked to seal.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Was it toasted marshmallow?
No, but it was sweet.
Why do they not flavor those?
It's probably just made with gelatin.
You know how usually when you like lick a letter, it's like okay, so the envelopes that I like to put our rent in, they taste gross, like real, like disgusting. But this one, I was like, wow, this is good.
I have some insight into this because I made like lickable stickers in college, which is sort of a weird thing. But long story short, it was just like melted gelatin and sugar, so they just tasted like unsweetened, like just vaguely sweetened stuff. But it's probably not real gelatin. It's probably like a substitute at this point. Vegan lickable envelopes.
I'm in. Might just go buy some right now.
You know, we've made so many other things in this world, like nicely scented or nicely flavored or whatever. I don't get why envelopes aren't all flavored. Like, give us a little consolation prize when we're mailing our rent or like sending in our taxes. Like, I would love to just have like a little bit of artificial cherry flavoring on that envelope, you know, just to maybe feel like you tried.
I just buy like adhesive envelopes. I don't buy the lickable kind because that's yucky. Like, I think about that every time I receive a letter that's obviously like a lickable envelope, like saliva sealed envelope. Ugh.
So in a small bit of follow-up, y'all remember internet garbage kid from the past, Mason Ramsey, a.k.a. the Walmart yodeler?
Mm-hmm. Isn't he like 22 by now?
Surprisingly, no. He is still a small child. That was only like 2 months ago. Time marches on in the slowest possible way. But Mason sent out a tweet this week that I just felt like we needed to talk about. So the image we'll start with is a sad face emoji with a cowboy hat on it. And the text of the tweet that he sent says, "They always say yee-haw, they never ask, haw ye."
He didn't write that.
I also don't think he wrote it, but I spend a lot of time doing nothing on the internet. You know what? Full disclosure, I did not watch that video.
You haven't seen the Walmart yodeling kid?
No, I kind of am like, oh, everyone's freaking out about this. Close that.
I feel like we have to.
I don't feel like we have to do any of the internet things.
Yeah, I don't think we have to do any of the internet things. But I do think Mason or whoever originally wrote this brings up a good point. You know, why don't we ever ask ha ye?
That is that like wholesome meme type stuff.
Because it don't sound good.
But Tyler, ha ye.
I don't know. I feel yeehaw. Like I feel like it's different. If you're from Appalachia, I could definitely hear somebody doing it. Ha ye holler.
Ha ye.
Ha ye!
It's probably like some pig calling.
Yeah.
Like that sounds like some of that kind of not a language sound that those people use.
You get it. Yeah, you have to do like a really high pitched ye, like, ha ye!
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Like you gotta do something like that. Like it doesn't make
ah-yee.
It doesn't make a lot of sense. And meanwhile, all my neighbors are like, "That's it. This is it. I'm getting this kid evicted. No more pig calls."
I mean, I thought it was genuinely a good question. Like, why don't we ever ask? But then I clicked through and I looked at Mason's Twitter page just to see, like, ha ye, Mason, ha ye. And his Twitter bio, I'm just going to read it to you verbatim. No snake in these boots, ... Follow for more little Hank, smiley face. Managed by Mason's grandmother.
There you go.
Listen to my brand new song, Lovesick Blues, arrow pointing downward emoji.
Tight.
I wonder how old his grandmother is.
Grandma's
25.
She's
25. Jeez, Sean.
I mean, she could be like middle-aged. That's not too old for Twitter, you know? Depending on how old he is.
Since I love memes.
I love that he's like leaning totally into this, and the first sentence of his bio is, "No snake in these boots."
It is pretty good. He is wearing a cowboy hat.
Like, when you're a walking meme, you know, you might as well just own it.
They say white people have no culture.
Oh boy.
So our main discussion this week is gonna be primarily led by Catherine, who is going to catch us all up on the virtual / anime band / solo project Gorillaz. I legit don't know what to call Gorillaz anymore, but they / it has a new album coming out, and so we wanted to kind of catch up on where the project is now and how we should read the new album.
Well, I feel like I should start out by my disclaimer is that I'm not a Gorillaz historian or anything like that. Like, most of my trivia is going to come from research I did literally today. But I have been on the internet for a really long time, so I remember when, you know, I'm sure a lot of us remember when Feel Good Inc. was, like, everywhere. Tyler and I even talked about it this week. Like, that was just, you don't even want to hear it sometimes because it was everywhere. But Gorillaz is called a virtual band, and it was established by Damon Albarn, that's pretty well known, and Jamie Hewlett, which is one of my favorite artists, who also worked on Tank Girl and a couple of their, like, kind of well-known projects. But, yeah. They did some, like, hologram shows and stuff that were, I don't know if they were pioneering that format or anything, but they were. Gorillaz shows are a big deal, and I'm pretty sure all the tickets are sold out for their upcoming show, too.
But I would say what kind of sparked this idea was we were watching the, what was the new song? Humility? Is that the name of it?
Yeah, that's the new song.
Yeah. Yeah, so this new video came out, and that kind of combined with Jamie Hewlett's, like, social media antics has kind of created this interest where there was a, what was it, Catherine, was it the Instagram post first, or was there something else that sparked this interest?
I think there were a couple interviews on websites that I don't follow music news, so I wouldn't have read them. I did read one after looking this up, but my first exposure to it was seeing Ace and Noodle together on Jamie Hewlett's Instagram. And I was like, that's Ace from Powerpuff Girls. And that's what got a lot of this kind of, I don't want to call it hype started, but everyone's like, that's Ace from the Powerpuff Girls. It's Ace from the Powerpuff Girls. Like, greatest crossover event in history, better than Infinity War. Like, and that was a really big deal because that doesn't make any sense and there's no reason for that at all. Like, that's really good though. That's definitely up my alley because I love Powerpuff Girls and Ace is, like, famously the best Gangrene Gang member. So
we thought that he was dating Noodle, and then the development then became that I guess Murdoch, which is one of the members of the band, is in jail.
Mm-hmm.
And there's suspicion that somehow they got Ace and Murdoch confused because they look basically the same if you're not paying very close attention.
So I was looking this up, and the Murdoch was, he says he was framed, but he was definitely partaking in some kind of illicit activity during the strobe light video. It happens, like, at the end of the video.
A song from a previous album.
That's
And so we should point out that everything we're talking about right now, all of the, like, people, so to speak, that we're referring to, other than Jamie Hewlett, are fictional animated characters who are the quote-unquote members of this band, which is what kind of makes Gorillaz so interesting to talk about, is there's a series of characters, like cartoon and vaguely 3D animated, that make up the band itself, but all of the musical elements of the band are kind of, like, puppeteered by real life human beings, and that group of people is led by Damon Albarn, former frontman of the band Blur. And so when you talk about Gorillaz, it's really hard sometimes to, like, create this separation between Damon Albarn and Jamie Hewlett, the illustrator of these characters, and the characters that the two of them have created that are in some ways, like, the most important and least important part of Gorillaz. Like, it's really fascinating and strange.
See, that's an interesting take to me, because I would say, like, Gorillaz is not the first, like, non-real band historically. Like, they had some television shows, like Josie and the Pussycats, you know, like, you could even throw back to something as far back as that, where they did, like, cartoons about bands, which is funny, right? And then having a cartoon band, finally. I don't know exactly what year they, like, started up.
1998.
Thank you.
This is their 20th anniversary year, which is kind of crazy.
I know a lot of people's first exposure to them was, I can't think of the name of anything all of a sudden. It was Clint Eastwood, because it was like, oh, it's a virtual band and it's animated, and that was really exciting back then to have, like, it's exciting still to have an animated music video.
Yeah, this probably dates me a little bit, but I remember the first time I saw the Clint Eastwood video was in a Journeys in the Eastgate Mall.
Oh, no.
And I was trying on shoes and I was like, this song's really good. It was way before I had any idea of, like, who Blur was or Del the mm-hmm. Funky Homosapien or, like, any of the other people associated with the project. I just saw the video and thought, the video is weird, but I really like this song, and also I'm gonna buy these Chuck Taylors.
is a weird video. I rewatched it today in like preparation for this, and I was like, man, this is like really bizarre. And a lot of that doesn't make any sense until you actually read about this like lore that goes with gorillas. Like all the actual, like the zombie gorillas. That's kind of weird, even though that's the band name.
And so we've all talked about our primary exposure. I'm curious, Sean, where was your first exposure to gorillas?
Feel Good Inc.
Really?
It was a music video on VH1. It just snapped. I was like, wow, this is great.
Yeah, I think it was that. Like, it was definitely... Or it was definitely an iPod commercial. If you would have...
There were a lot of...
What iPod commercial?
Yeah.
Oh, Catherine. There you go. It's in the Skype chat.
Sorry, I have to look this up. Oh, thank you.
Yeah, there was an original iPod commercial with Feel Good Inc. I forgot about that.
That's so relevant. Oh, I remember this now. That's weird.
It was such a moment in time that, like, that song got huge right as those iPod commercials got huge.
Yeah.
Ripperoni. Right?
Courage, everyone. That's what...
It is kind of funny, though, because, and I'm sure we'll, like, work our way through the progression, but for me, my, like, interest in gorillas kind of ebbed and flowed over the course of the body of work.
Mm-hmm.
When Clint Eastwood came out, I remember, like, really enjoying that song, and I think I probably bought it on iTunes, but I didn't really pay attention to the rest of that album. And then Demon Days came out, and Feel Good Inc. was such a huge hit, and that album was... so immensely popular. I remember owning the CD of it, and like everybody I knew had a copy of that, and it was just popular on a level that like an alternative album hadn't been really since American Idiot, I don't think. And it was such a huge deal. And then I kind of fell off the train there for a while, but then somewhere in late high school or early college, I came back to those first two Gorillaz albums, and I started to realize like who all of the people were behind these cartoon characters, and it became this totally different fascination to me of like, who is Damon Albarn and who is Jamie Hewlett? And then you start digging a little bit deeper and you're like, oh, the reason that that rap verse on Clint Eastwood is so good is because it's Del the Funky Homosapien, who's been in the rap scene for like 20 years and is like immensely talented. And all of the bass lines on that first Gorillaz album are played by Tina Weymouth, who was the bass player in Talking Heads.
Oh shit.
And when Gorillaz went on tour for Demon Days, they brought two members of The Clash on tour with them as their bassist and their drummer. And like all of a sudden it all starts to come together and you're like, oh, this band is good because it's made up of like literally the best musicians on earth.
And you're like, you gotta be, that's gonna be a pretty good gig, right? They're like, do you want to perform like 10 shows? No one has to see you per se, and you get to not have to write any of it. You just have to play these pretty good songs. You're like, well, yeah, of course.
So I just learned this from reading the Wikipedia page, but when they started having more and more live shows and like having a live band, like this is when Jamie Hewlett was kind of moving away from the project because he felt like no one cared that he was involved in it anymore. It was like, there's why you get like half the Clash on the stage, you know, like, and that what's funny, there's some supplementals that coincide with that are like the Gorillaz, it's Gorillaz stuck in a dressing room while the live band plays, and Murdoch calls them a Gorillaz cover band, which is pretty good.
Yeah, you do kind of get some of that frustration, I'm sure, that Jamie Hewlett was feeling of like, what do I do when you're all out on stage?
Enjoy the masterpiece you've created.
I mean, it looks like they kind of made up though, because look at Jamie Hewlett's Instagram. Like, it's just...
It's a lot, like, of gorillas.
50% gorillas, yeah.
And since that peak, I think, too, Gorillaz has moved back into being a studio project,
mm-hmm.
which is in some ways, like, what it was always kind of destined to be. Like, looking back at some of my favorite Gorillaz songs, they're ones that have crazy studio collaborations that you could never take on the road. Like,
yeah.
Do Your Thing is always one of my favorites, but there's no way that you could get James Murphy of LCD Sound System and Andre 3000 from Outkast to, like, go on tour with you for an entire year.
Right. Or Snoop Dogg.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you're not gonna get Snoop Dogg to come on your Gorillaz tour for 10 months. Like,
probably several choirs.
Oh, yeah.
That's an entire true. Orchestra.
See, this what I find interesting about your all's interest in gorillas is that, I mean, obviously you all have a lot more like technical knowledge about music, let's call it. Meanwhile, I'm like, who did that song? I don't even know. Tyler makes fun of me because I don't know anything. I always say like, I don't know anything about music. So to me, Gorillaz is just this virtual band, and I know some names behind it. And I know that some of those names are important, even important to me, but I still find myself in love with the virtual band members, which is maybe classic me. But like, I think 2D being kind of the front man, but everybody's in love with Murdoch is interesting too. I don't know.
Yeah, so let's talk about those virtual band members for a little bit, right? So you have kind of the four key cartoon virtual band members, 2D, Murdoch, Noodle, and Russell. And there's a rotating cast of like ancillary characters that come in and out. But are there particular members that y'all identify with or that you find like more interesting than others? Or are the animated characters even important to you? Like, Catherine kind of tipped her hand, but I'm curious from the whole panel, like, how do the cartoon characters play into Gorillaz for you?
Well, I would say for me, I think it almost depends on almost album by album, because you kind of notice that through each album, I mean, because it's illustrated by an illustrator, you know, someone who just draws like a lot, you see that they always have different outfits, and they're always kind of like, Jamie's always kind of doing something different with their look, kind of like trying to evoke a different kind of like style with them. And so you notice that Noodle, about halfway through, she just grows up or whatever. Something happens. Like, she.
Yeah. Yeah, I noticed that, too.
She's a much taller individual. And so you see her kind of have like these kind of really, really interesting looks. She's not like so like infantile anymore. But I just think it's kind of cool, like how they're always kind of just changing their looks, like almost seemingly between every album, you know, like such frequency. But I'd have to specifically look at the characters, but I guess I like Noodle. Noodle's, I think she's got good outfits, and I think 2D is just a, he's kind of the almost the lovable oaf in this scenario, because it feels like he's always just kind of vacant, which is, I think it's kind of the point of him being the singer, right? But I think he's got some good outfits too.
Sean, what do you think of the cartoon characters? Do you have a favorite? Are they inconsequential? How do you feel?
I don't necessarily think I have a favorite. I think that the cartoon characters work out really well for this band because the lineup has changed so much, because they have such a diverse range of songs that they can perform the music live. Like, I was just watching a 2018 live concert of the Gorillaz, and when they came to play Clint Eastwood, like, they didn't have whoever the rapper was who performed the first section of the song, so they just had the music video playing in the background. Not to mention that, like, it seemed like in general a lot of the concert was backed up by heavy visuals, heavy cinematography, which is fine, but I feel like if it was just somebody on stage with a recording playing in the back, like it was just Damon standing at the front with a recording playing in the background, you'd be like, oh my god, this is Willie Vanilli, except it's 2018.
Right, this is a bad look. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, like, it really adds something to there. But I think that everybody, even if they did do that, you'd be so used to the visual component of it, I don't think it would be complete. You know, like, could you imagine going to a bar and seeing the Gorillaz?
No.
No. No, I cannot. Like, I would have to almost see them in some sort of, like, larger venue or almost arena, because the music is built for that.
Right. I would imagine that, I don't exactly remember the stuff that they use, but like when Hatsune Miku performs, like, she's like almost kind of like almost necessarily, not necessarily in the crowd, but she's very close. And because they use like so many different like projectors or whatever, it people say that she feels pretty real for being a hologram. And there's lots of like really sophisticated animation. So, I mean, I think you could probably get them into a bar. I think it would take a lot of money and a lot of time, and tickets would be $200 to $5.
Well, so that's a trick, right? Because that the cheap holograms don't cost that much to make. You can, like, it's a prism with projectors on it, and you could just lay the track over it. And I'm, like, kind of into that idea. Like, it's kind of Star Warsy to me to just have, like, a miniature band on every table kind of idea. Like, that's kind of fun to me. I think that so far we've seen virtual bands be like these larger than life, competitive with real musicians, like actual human beings that are bands. We've seen them come to compete with that, but I think that they can be micro-sized, and like there has to be a way to make that a portable experience, I think.
Yeah, that's kind of an interesting point, Catherine, because I feel like for me, Gorillaz is so like inextricably tied to the iPod and to the portable experience.
Really?
Yeah, like I just remember so heavily like getting into Gorillaz right around the time I got my first iPod, and like,
yeah, I guess so.
There was something so cool and interesting about like, you don't have CDs anymore. You just have this little box and it has all of your music on it. And then there's this band that's like not really there, but they're like a cartoon band and they're in your iPod. And like, there was something so cool about that moment in time. And watching these videos back today, it was like this weird kind of time warp to that period where everything before the Plastic Beach album really feels like the early 2000s. Technology is new and interesting and weird, and you know, anything you do is going to be revolutionary and new because nobody's worked in this kind of digital space before. And it all felt so fresh in a way.
That's a really good point about like Gorillaz is really an iPod band, if you could call them that. What's the primary way that most people would have listened to Gorillaz? And that, like, pre-Plastic Beach, let's say, because that became really about, we were kind of in the YouTube streaming, you know, kind of era by then. Maybe not 100% like we are now, but we were certainly getting there. But, I mean, I certainly listened to the most Gorillaz on my personal iPod as well, like pre-smartphone even. What's everyone's favorite Gorillaz album?
That's a really easy question for me. It's got to be Demon Days. And I loved Demon Days as a kid. It came out when I was in middle school. So it was, you know, right at the perfect moment for me to be really into music. And it wasn't until years and years later that I realized that it's produced by Brian Danger Mouse Burton.
Mm-hmm.
The more I learned about him and his work, I realized that some of my favorite albums of all time are all produced by Danger Mouse. And so it was just like, oh yeah, it makes sense that I really like that one Gorillaz record because it's that same production style, those big strings and that kind of like nostalgic, like wall of sound style production that I really enjoy.
Someone else, who's your favorite Gorillaz album? Fine, I'll go. I have an answer. So I want to say Demon Days, like maybe that's a popular answer, but I have to give a shout out though to D-Sides, because as much as I like Demon Days, I feel like, I don't know, it's really good. But I also like a lot of the supplemental stuff that was on D-Sides, even though some of that involved other people, but like Murdoch is God and Spitting Out the Demons are so good. And I can't like think about my favorite Gorillaz songs without thinking about those, even though like the remixes are fine on there. That's on the second disc, but that of course comes from Demon Days, so.
But those are all just like B-sides and like single tracks and stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
From that album, yeah.
I think that's, you're allowed to say that. And I'll say that because Less Than Jake has a B-sides album that I also like a lot more than some of their albums. So I think it's totally legit to like a B-sides album.
I really also like a lot of their the supplemental materials in general, though. Like that spoken word bit about the whatever it's called, I can't remember now. But doing some spoken word stuff is good, and doing some stuff that's a little more challenging maybe to put on a regular album. I just really like that.
Are those 3D like rigged videos only on Instagram?
What? Oh, those weird ones?
Yeah.
Yeah, I couldn't find those really short ones where it's just like, yeah, Murdoch and 2D like sitting and talking. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that those were just tests in order for them to do Sleeping Probably Powder sleeping, yeah, and like the dancing one, or strobe light.
Gotcha. Because I want. It's not. I think those are fun as like a non-content version of like of stuff that they produce.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, I would say that I think mine's definitely Plastic Beach because it feels like the most like has the most like bangers on it. You know, like it feels like you go through it and you're like, this is a hit. This is a hit. Like they're songs that feel memorable. They have like a good hook. They usually have a pretty good like guest vocalist on it. You know, it has like a sound that's usually like pretty like almost sort of thematic. This is like just drenched in theme. Of course, I like Demon Days. You know, that was one of the first albums I ever bought. But I would say that there's a lot of, like, sort of, like, almost atmospheric or kind of very, very, almost, like, kind of lo-fi kind of songs in there that kind of, like, are inner, kind of mixed in between, you know, like, Feel Good Inc., Dare, Dirty Harry, and stuff like that. And I don't want to say it feels like filler, but it just feels a little, you know, they're not songs that you're going to want to put out, you know, as, like, here, listen to this. This is, you know, like, you're probably not going to put on a mixtape. But Placid Beach, to me, just had so many songs. I was like, I can put all of these. All these on a mix. I'm tempted also to say, though, I'm excited for this one. The new one's coming out.
Yeah, me too. The Now?
Yeah. I was not a huge fan of Humans. I will admit that it's probably just wasn't my taste, and that's fine. But there was good stuff on there. But I'm excited for the Now. And especially because, I mean, if Humility is any like sort of like indication of what it'll kind of sound like, I think it'll be good.
Sean, do you have a favorite?
Probably Demon Days. But I think self-titled was nice, too. I have to admit that I am a singles listener when it comes to Gorillaz. I really don't listen to their whole albums. But Plastic Beach wasn't bad either. But this is me saying that. Okay, cut through it all. The one that I listen to the most entirely, Demon Days.
I think there's something really interesting to be said about, like, the phases of Gorillaz.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that first album, that self-titled album, is so all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
And it really feels, at least to me, like Damon Albarn just trying to do anything that isn't Blur.
Right.
You know, it's like, I don't want to be in a Brit rock band anymore. And then Demon Days is kind of the moment where he seizes on the, like, hip-hop, trip-hop kind of style and collaborates with Danger Mouse and just tons of amazing guests on that record. And then Plastic Beach is all about experimentation and, like, if I could collaborate with anyone on earth, who would it be? And it's like Snoop Dogg and Lou Reed and, like, just total legends on that one.
Oh yeah, that was so good. That's such a good song off the album.
Yeah, and then you get into, like, the kind of not downward slope, but things definitely take a more, like, the tone shifts. They stop being, like, the huge name of, like, everybody wants to work with Gorillaz, I think, right around The Fall. And The Fall doesn't get enough credit because it was recorded entirely on an iPad while they were on tour.
Mm-hmm.
Which I think is great. And, like, it's not a fantastic album, but it is kind of cool as, like, a document to say, you know, we made this whole album on the road. And then Human...
It was also free.
Yeah, and it was a free download, which was very much a thing of that moment and kind of cool. And then there was the really long hiatus. And I have to say, I was not a huge fan of Humans either. I don't think it went to the places that people expected. And with some of the collaborators that they had on there, you know, people like Vince Staples that could have given, you know, a truly amazing performance, they all did well, but nothing on this record was like, oh wow, you have to hear that Danny Brown verse, or like, oh, that De La Soul feature is so good. Like, they all just felt very run-of-the-mill, like exactly what you would expect. And so I'm hoping that with the Now, there's some kind of, like, unique or interesting or groundbreaking thing that's happening. Because that's what I come to Gorillaz for. It's like, we gave Damon Albarn the benefit of the doubt. He has all the tools in the toolbox to just make the weirdest, kookiest, funkiest album he can. And I really want to see him push the envelope.
And I'll say, so have you all listened to Humility?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think, for me, what the exciting part about it was the George Benson feature, which, if you don't know, he's like a pretty famous, like, jazz guitarist. And I think what excites me most about it is sort of like almost the like touch of like city pop, kind of like vapor wavy kind of twinge in the background there, because it's like, it's a pretty chill track. And it feels like, you know, and the music video probably helps too, that he's like hanging out on the beach. And I'm kind of like, is that going to be the vibe? You know, it just feels, you're like, ooh, this is summer. It feels, it's just like drenching in the kind of like these ideas from like long ago, or, you know, maybe like 80s, you know, like sort of a little retro, a little vintage, you know, but it still feels kind of fresh. And that's what's kind of exciting about it, is that it feels a little bit old, a little bit of new.
I want to talk about this new era, but I want to hear from everyone else first.
Yeah.
Also, Jack Black in the music video, just so good.
Also so good. And you're like, I feel like we hated Jack Black for a pretty long time as a society, but I'm like, Jack Black could be in a Gorillaz video. It's okay.
So that's weird. I see a lot of love for his presence in the video. Like, a lot of people are like, yeah, Jack Black's in it, so obviously it's good. You know, like, which is kind of a weird, I don't know if that's what I would expect, the reaction.
He's kind of the Guy Fieri of music.
The Guy Fieri of a lot of things.
Guy Fieri of a lot of things.
Well, I want to, okay, is it cool if I talk about, like, the story for a minute?
Yeah, let's talk about the backstory of Gorillaz a little bit.
So I don't want to bore us all with, like, immense details here. But some real quick trivia before I talk about the new video and what that means. 2D has a real name. His original name, I think, let me see if I can find his full original name. But it's Stuart Pott, I think. And he went by Stew Pott. And Murdoch is the reason that his eyes are black. Because it's a real medical condition that makes your eyes, like, there's blood in your eyes. And the reason I mention that is because, so, like, 2D is sort of well-known character design-wise because he's got these black, vacant eyes. And that's kind of creepy, but we kind of learn to love that about that character design. And in Humility, his eyes are white, which is really important lore-wise because it means that he's like... So Murdoch's in jail. And if you don't know, Murdoch kind of abuses 2D a lot. Like, historically, he abuses him the entire time. And so for Murdoch to be in jail... There's even an interview on Noisy that it's like 2D coming into his own and he's like kind of free from this negative influence. And that's why the blood's drained out of his eyes and he's like, oh, it's optimism. And you can see at the end of the video that Russell trips him and his eyes go back to being black, which people are taking to mean like, oh, it's the negativity like coming back in there for a second. And yeah. Which I thought was really, like, I just kind of learned more about that in researching why it was that way for the video. So I don't know if you all noticed that or not.
Yeah, I was watching the video as you were kind of giving this description. And it is interesting reading it that way, because I've also always thought of 2D as, like, the personification of Damon Albarn in the band.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So he sings with different voices throughout the project, and whenever he sings in his, like, quote-unquote natural vocal range, it's usually shown on screen as 2D. And so I just always kind of assumed that when 2D is on screen, that's who Damon Albarn is as a person. And so, yeah, that's a really interesting read of, like, maybe he was in this really negative place and now is suddenly, like, coming out of it into a mode of positivity.
I did want to mention, too, we were talking about Plastic Beach briefly, and when Tyler and I were talking about Gorillaz this week, we mentioned, or I mentioned that there was an evil noodle for that storyline. And there's a lot of, like, yeah, there's a lot of storyline that you can just read about it. But a lot of people didn't put that together unless you were participating in that kind of, like, the culture of Gorillaz when that was all coming out. But Murdoch made a fake evil noodle when he couldn't find her because she was, like, somewhere. I don't know. And Noodle comes back onto the scene and she, like, that's why there's two noodles in the videos. Like, there's a robot one, evil robot one, and then the regular noodle. And she, I don't really know if we get to see what happens to that evil robot version, but like, the return of Noodle was this kind of, like, miniature Gorillaz fandom exciting moment because you're like, Noodle's back and it's the real Noodle and she's, like, shooting up the bad guys, you know? Like, that was a lot of fun, I think.
Wait, what video is this?
This was in the, like, the supplementals and videos for Plastic Beach.
Oh.
Yeah. There was a lot of storyline kind of stuff for that. You can see the real noodle in, like, some of the official artwork for, it's called Phase 3 of Gorillaz, because she's got the mask on. So that's real noodle. But, yeah. And then we have real noodle in the band now. But that kind of, like, little stuff, I feel like if you are a fan of Gorillaz, you're rewarded by paying attention to that kind of weird little stuff, like, oh, 2D's eyes changed color, and that's the real noodle. And I don't even know what other stuff there could be for that.
Yeah, you're definitely rewarded for watching all the music videos and following the characters, which is a level of this musical, like, collaboration project, I guess. I struggle to call it a band, but, like, it's a level of this thing that I've always appreciated but never really engaged with. But I love that it's there, you know? Are we ready for some internet garbage?
I guess so.
Yeah.
I'm glad because, ooh, baby, do I have a good one for you. I found this, and I haven't even watched the whole thing, but the title alone makes me feel like it's going to be a good internet garbage for this show. I present to you all Aerosmith on the Water, Freestyle Canoeing in February.
Oh my god, I'm already excited. I can't contain myself.
How come I get in trouble for making you all listen to covers that you think are bad, but you can send me this garbage, and you're like, this is incredible.
I know this is gonna be good already.
Thanks for the great paddling, Dave.
God bless you, Wisconsin. You brought us cheese and freestyle canoeing. Forever. Here we go.
I can't pop. Don't wanna fall
asleep. Who's that? What's that guy?
Who's in the woods?
Oh wow. I feel bad, like, if I were to even begin laughing at this, primarily because this is the kind of thing that small towns do for their, big events. Like, it's a local thing, you know?
I would move to that town in a heartbeat.
Hold on. We have to, there's,
we have to finish the video and then we can talk about it. There's got to be a big finish that we're all waiting for.
There's two boys from a faraway angle.
It doesn't really seem synchronized in any way to me.
Well, no, it's not freestyle.
It's freestyle, Catherine. Jesus.
Okay, but, like...
Oh, they almost wrecked. Look, they were so close to each other, but they somehow managed to save it. The professionalism is just out of control.
Yeah. Oh, it's just a cutaway. Never mind, didn't work.
A fucking song that they made for a disaster movie.
When you say it like that, it really takes all the romance out of this song, man.
You by now have heard the excerpts of our conversation during this video, but you really just need to pause the podcast, go to the show notes, and watch this video for yourself, and then come back. It's okay, I'll give you a minute. Because this may be the most elegant and beautiful piece of internet garbage we've seen in years. Basically, what's happening here is two grown men in canoes freestyling to the romantic stylings of Steven Tyler and Aerosmith singing, I Don't Want to Miss a Thing. And at first you think, oh, maybe this is going to be some kind of like gorgeous choreographed canoe routine. That's not what you're getting yourself in for here.
I made that mistake too.
This is just two men paddling around in circles, sometimes close to each other, sometimes very far apart. And that's it.
Now, as it turns out, in a canoe, you have a pretty limited range of movements. So it really boils down to of how close can I get to tipping this canoe over without going over? Like, you got a $1 bob this thing, and you gotta make sure you don't get water in this canoe.
It is, like, deeply satisfying for the first minute, though, like, how close they get to sinking before righting themselves and not getting any water in the canoes.
It's certainly performance.
You, like, want them to, like, do, like, flips and shit, right? Like, you want them to, to like, 360 no-scope and, like, just... But these are canoes! There's no motor! It's just the man in a blue boat.
I mean, like I said, I would feel bad laughing because it's, like, really genuine. And I don't think it's, like, ha-ha funny. It's not ha-ha funny for me. Like, I feel probably because I'm from a small town. So to me, I'm like, yeah, you could set lots of county fair events to music. Like, you know, I don't know. I want to see other versions of freestyle canoe. The other music, though.
I think the thing that really drives it home for me is, like, how it starts so beautifully and you think it's going to be one thing, and then it turns out to just be, like, deeply underwhelming in every way.
Like, I wanted there to be like 20 canoes, like just all.
What if their outfits were exciting? I think if they had like sequin jackets or something, I would be like, wow, they really put a lot of effort in. Or if like their canoes were really exciting somehow, I'd be like, yeah, okay. But that isn't what happened.
Right. Like Catherine and I were joking, like, if we had a wedding, what we had, that we got to do something crazy. Like, I'm like, Catherine, you're going to be the Jade Emerald Princess with like from like fucking Big Trouble Little China. And I'm like, well, I guess I'm like a fucking French pirate captain. Like, I'm like, we need some theatrics here. Like, that would go a long way.
You have to do the whole ceremony in canoes.
Oh.
Some people, I guarantee that somebody's done that. I have no doubt that, like, every weird thing you can think of doing for a wedding has been done. People are nut bar.
Sean, I know you're a big Aerosmith fan. Do you think they did Steven Tyler justice here?
Oh, my God. Yes, definitely. I mean, as somebody who is new to the arguably non-arguable amazing sport of synchronized rhythmic canoeing, this is like the perfect way to blow a whole Saturday. I mean, like, you get like a 30 pack of like Genesee cream. You take yourself out to the woods and you just sit back and you let somebody with a laptop that's been made in 2004 blast some you know, kazaa tunes out of their speakers and just, I don't know, eat out of a picnic basket. I think that that's really honestly like the true, this is a sport that was built for spectation.
No
other sport.
I completely agree, but also I think the question I have to ask is, how big of a bottle can you get an ale aid in? Because I feel like I need like a 40.
At least 5 liters. The Kentucky Slammer of ale 8. 5 liters of nothing but straight ale 8. We got more caffeine in here.
See, maybe I'm not laughing because I'm from a place where I'm just... It's just too real. Yeah, I can't find my way to being like, ha ha. I'm like, well, you know, sometimes there's not anything else to do when you live in the middle of nowhere. So you would take a big pack of beer out and your best friends that know how to use a camera and do your freestyle canoeing to Aerosmith.
Now, you bring up an interesting point, Catherine, because in the video, there is an on-screen text call out. So there's like...
Yeah.
Some little like Windows Movie Maker captions at the bottom. And the uploader, during one shot, it says, he added this caption that says, "This is Dave. Thanks for great paddling, dot, dot." So, like, first of all...
Wow, Dave.
Too lazy for the third dot. But also, I mean, way to go, Dave. But then there's third friend who is off to the side, clearly taking video of this experience. And I'm just thinking, where is his thank you?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, Dave did some arguably great paddling. But, you know...
Did it name both of them?
I don't know. I'm just checking Dave. Now.
They did say thank you for watching at the end.
So, the question that we have to ask, of course, because this is Dude's Brunch, I want a real answer from everyone on the panel for this. If you were to do a synchronized freestyle canoeing routine, what song would you choose?
I'm glad that you asked that question, Taylor, because I was prepared for such a moment, because I decided that the song Annoyed Grunt from Mouth Moods, I think, is the perfect song to play to several men really, really out there stroking their paddles, making big 360s in the water.
Dope, indeed.
Oh, I know mine. The Beauty and the Beast song. You know, what's that one called? The one they sing in the ballroom.
Tale as old as time.
Is that the name of that song, though?
Song yes, it is. As
rhyme. Is it really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Beauty and the Beast.
It does fit the elegance of canoes. I would give you that, Kevin.
Yeah, doesn't it sound great?
Sean, what's your pick?
Bleed by Meshuggah. Hey, I'm being real. If I'm doing freestyle canoeing, I'm getting that rage out.
You know, Sean, you have inspired me, because revisiting Bleed by Meshuggah has made me realize what my freestyle canoeing song would be. I think if you're going to freestyle canoe, you better be in all black. Black canoe, black paddle, black eyeliner.
I'm Not Okay by My Chemical Romance?
No, and you better be paddling to Wings of a Butterfly by him.
Oh my god. No. Okay, listen. Totally serious here. Probably one of the most underrated albums of our lifetime.
I saw on Apple Music that you were listening to that album this week, and I just had to go there.
Please listen to that album all the way through as an adult. You will be like, you know what? This is kind of childish, but it is pretty good.
You heard it here first, folks. Dark Light by him. Possibly the best album of our lifetime, according to Sean Evans.
No, I didn't say I said underrated albums of our lifetime. I did not say possibly the best.
Misread that situation.
Let's make it real clear. Not the best. Very underrated.
Not even necessarily good. Just disproportionately rated badly.
All I'm saying is someday when Sean and I both retire to the backwoods of Wisconsin, you'll find us on a Saturday drunk on Genesee Cream Ale canoeing to him.
Oh, I have a runner-up for mine. My runner-up song is Colors of the Wind from Pocahontas.
Oh my god.
So basic.
You realize that's like the quintessential.
I think I'm winning this competition of who has the best idea.
If there is a quintessential synchronized canoeing song, it's that.
That's like the Seven Nation Army of soccer, but for canoeing.
I'm right about this. I can't believe we're talking about your other music more than we're talking about the best Disney songs to do freestyle or synchronized canoeing to.
And it's time to round out the show like we always do with a round of shameless plugs. We will start with Tyler Reed. Tyler, the heavens are ablaze in your eyes. Where can the people see them?
Hello, fellow teens. You can find my design and illustration work at tylerdreed.com. And you can find me on the socials as TDRDesign on Instagram and Twitter.
Sean, I would rip out the wings of a butterfly for your soul.
For my soul.
Where can the people find you online?
They can find me on the internet at Real Cash Otter. And can I make a small shout out?
Of course.
Okay. So I know that none of you guys are sport puck fans, which is understandable.
Uh-huh.
But this week, my favorite sport puck team, the Washington Capitals, won the Stanley Cup. And it was very exciting, very dramatic, and it was so refreshing.
Didn't they hold it up at a baseball game yesterday?
Yep. You can basically do whatever you want with a Stanley Cup. I don't know why that's just like something that they can do, but yeah, I think they get like one day, like one whole day where every player gets one day to go around and do whatever they want. So if they want to like eat soup out of it, they can do it. If they want to like fart in it and like throw the cup into a crowd, I think that's like they're not liable for anything that happens as long as they're touching the cup. I'm not sure exactly how that works, but
if you collect 6 Stanley Cups, do you have ultimate power?
Ooh, I'm not sure.
Okay.
And of course, our guest for the evening, Catherine DiMartino. Catherine, the blood on your hands is the wine.
You couldn't have picked a better line than that one. That's the one, like...
There really aren't that many lyrics to Wings of a Butterfly by him.
How about My Song is as Old as Time?
There you go,
that's
Catherine.
That's even better.
Your song is as old as time. Where can the people find you on the internet?
You can check my web portfolio, illustration mostly, at CatherineDiMartino.com. I'm on most socials as Ixelent. That's IXELLENT. Except for Twitter, which is Ixelcoatl, because you know how it goes with three names.
That's right, Real Cash Otter.
I honestly think you should reintroduce Catherine and say, come on and show them your love or something, you know, like...
No, because I'm saving that for right now. So thanks again to my amazing panel. Come on and show them your love. I would rip out the wings of a butterfly for them, and I know that you would too.
I hate you.
You can follow me on the socials as at TC Olmsted. You can like and follow the show at Dudes Brunch. If you really like what we do here, you can leave a review on iTunes or recommend us on Overcast or, you know, tell somebody about the show. That's how people find it. Other than that, thanks for listening, and we'll be back next week with another episode of Dudes Brunch.
A girl with fighting for